On one deep summer night, a young man sneaked to the Chernobyl Unit 4 reconstruction site. The evening shift ended and the place was almost empty. Yet, he moved silently, stopping behind construction containers and checking that no one sees him. Then he approached the massive wall of the reactor building and found a metal ladder. In a few minutes, shielded by darkness and rumble of ventilation systems, he reached the roof, 72 meters or nearly 240 feet above the ground. Beneath that roof, the nuclear reactor was running, and yet the man was interested in something else. In front of him was raising the gigantic ventilation stack. And so he started to climb again, level by level, moving like a shadow until he reached level enough high to finally sit on metal floor and catch his breath. And now all he needed was to patiently wait, to see the most breathtaking sunrise in his life from the tallest place in the entire Chernobyl region. But unknowingly to the young man, someone eventually noticed him, and by morning he was locked in one of the holding cells at the Pripyat police department. We can only guess how things developed for him, but in the archive of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant there is one document. It was signed by power plant director Viktor Bryukhanov and confirming most likely the most unpleasant hours of that young man's life. July 1st, 1983, to the Pripyat City People's Court, to People's Judge Comrade Vovchenko V.N., City of Pripyat, External Number 36. The incident involving the unauthorized entry and overnight stay on the ventilation stack of Unit 3 by citizen Sageda V.N. was investigated by a commission. It consisted of the Chernobyl Nuclear Power Plant Administration, the Command of Military Unit 3561, the Main Directorate of Internal Troops of the USSR Ministry of Internal Affairs, Colonel Afonsky, and the Association Soyuz Atom Energo, Comrade Barykin. The commission noted that the temporary wall between Units 3 and 4, as well as the roof of the turbine hall, are vulnerable in terms of potential unauthorized access to the secured area of the plant from the construction site of Unit 4. As a temporary measure, a guard post had been placed at the end wall between Units 3 and 4, manned by sentries. Several violators of the security regime had been detained. Some of their cases have been referred to the prosecutor's office. Director Viktor Bryukhanov. It is actually a good question how severe were charges this citizen Sageda VN received, because no further documents remained, or maybe they are just in another archive. But that was 1983, the time of the Yuri Andropov's rule, which was characterized by increased role of the KGB and quite elevated attention to security. So we checked the legislation of the time, and it seems that the outcome could have ranged from a heavy fine to even a few years in prison. But what is certain, however, is that years later, this man surely read the news. And he was stunned by the horrifying realization of what was unfolding right in front of the chimney where he previously had dared to spend the night. And yet, neither he nor the majority of Soviet citizens knew what nightmares and challenges this chimney would actually witness next. And to understand that, it's quite essential to look at what makes it so special. The nuclear power plant has a very big ventilation system. It is designed to maintain a stable microclimate for its very complex equipment, and also to remove various gases which are produced during operation. So, there are a lot of pipes, and they all lead to ventilation centers, each connected to one of the chimneys. At Units 1 and 2, the ventilation center is located inside their shared system building, so the vent stack stands separately and it looks like one you would see at a coal power plant, except it is not for smoke. As for Units 3 and 4, things are a little bit different. Their ventilation center is located between them in the large hall 7001. As you will see soon, this room actually holds a dark story. The ventilation stack extends from its ceiling. It's 9 meters or 29 feet in diameter and rises around 150 meters or nearly 500 feet above ground. And as you can imagine, constructing such a giant installation was not a small feat. And thanks to one man, we can see now how it happened. These photos were taken around 1979 by Alexander Shubovsky, who was one of the builders. He wanted to create a small amateur documentary about his complex job as it really was, and so we see here welders, installers and other engineers. Most of these people climbed the reactor's chimney in the very morning and descended only in the evening, so when they, for example, needed a lunch break, food was delivered by a tower crane. The chimney even became a place for love stories and, of course, for friendships, because when you are doing such risky work, you surely need to trust the people beside you. So Alexander Shubovsky made his movie and left the reel in his apartment in the city of Pripyat. It is unknown whether it was ever shown on the screen, but what is known is that in February 1986, 2 months before Chernobyl disaster, he locked his apartment and left for a new construction project in another Soviet republic. He returned only a year later, only to find his city now turned into a ghost town. His apartment was also completely destroyed and the movie reel was gone. But miraculously, a roll of photo film survived, and he took it with him. Decades later, he donated it to the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, and that's why we can see it now. However, his photos reveal one not very obvious detail regarding the chimney's design. The main structure is actually the metal grid outside, because the pipe itself is made of quite thin metal suspended from the inside. In other words, if the grid is damaged, the pipe will collapse under its immense weight. And on April 26, 1986, after the explosion of Chernobyl Unit 4, it's actually a true miracle that it didn't happen. If you look closely, for example, at this image, you'll notice some structural elements were blown away. Yet, either the people Shubovsky photographed did their job exceptionally well, or the design had enough structural capacity, but the chimney continued to stand. But another serious problem appeared. All the platforms were now contaminated with highly radioactive debris, which had to be removed. And in our archive there is a very detailed report by Yuri Samoylenko, who coordinated the decontamination of the entire nuclear power plant. It is a long and very interesting document explaining how the work was done in various specific places, so if you want to read it, you can find the link in the description below. But this is how Samoylenko describes the situation with the chimney. 11. Zone T, ventilation stack. The survey was conducted using binoculars and radiation measurements were not performed during this period. On the first platform, in the western part, there is a continuous pile of graphite, and on the eastern side, there is a scatter of individual graphite pieces. The pile contains 9 reactor channels, each with the length of 5 to 7 meters, one of which has 3 graphite blocks. On the second platform, there is a pile of smaller graphite blocks, and as higher the level, as less debris is there. On the fifth platform there is only fine crumbs, and the topmost sixth platform is clean. Each of those graphite fragments was very dangerous, but pieces of fuel rods were even worse. But because of the height, there was no chance to use any machines to clean all that, and the only option was to send their people. According to Samoylenko, 500 soldiers worked there for 1.5 minutes each. They removed 21 tons of graphite and 1 ton of fuel fragments, but it was still far from over. October 1st, 1986 was the day of the relaunch of Reactor Unit 1, now repaired and heavily modernized. But the Soviet state, which invested colossal efforts in ideology, told its people they naturally needed symbols. And so, on the day of the reactor's restart, a Soviet flag had to appear at the very top of the ventilation stack. Opinions differ on who actually came up with this idea, either Samoylenko himself or it was Valery Starodumov. What is certain is that majority of liquidators considered it stupid and unnecessary action, and even management distanced themselves from it. In the National Museum of Chernobyl in Kiev, there is a laminated fragment of that very flag. And next to it is the original plan of the operation, showing marked radiation levels and a projected completion time of 25 minutes. The operation was carried out by three people, including Valery Starodumov himself. You can see how exactly it was done in the movie Chernobyl 3828 by Telecon Studio, which you can find on YouTube. It took the team just 9 minutes to climb and install the strange flag of victory, but perhaps it marked the victory of the Soviet system over itself. Because in reality, it was anything but the end. Andrew Mitingov, who was back then the head of the standalone radiation reconnaissance group, provides a good insight into this. In his book, he says that the cleanup of the roofs and the ventilation stack continued for at least 1 year afterward, and things didn't go as well as the newspapers reported. Below the chimney lies the ventilation center, so-called hole 7001. Radiation levels there varied from acceptable to very high because of beams coming from the debris through the roof, so great attention was needed while moving inside. In the ceiling, there is 9-meter opening for the vent stack, and in the floor, multiple large pipes connected to the vast ventilation system. Since all that continued operating for hours after the initial explosion, much debris became attached inside. And to get rid of it, liquidators knocked the pipes and the chimney using the sledgehammers. That made it very dangerous to be in the hole 7001 during that work, because all that debris would just fall down. And according to Mitingov, he knows one case, when, due to the poor coordination between workers, invisible but deadly dust particles fell inside while a man was there. This man had been sent to the power plant for only a few days for some engineering work, so he didn't know the specific details. After taking a shower and changing clothes, he checked himself with a dosimeter and found the radiation around him was 70 rontgens per hour. And after a failed attempt to locate the source, he came to the horrifying realization that the source was inside his lungs. Mitingov said that no matter what was done, no one could save him. And according to Samoylenko's report we mentioned earlier, during the 1986 cleanup of the chimney alone, 400 of the 500 workers involved were severely overexposed. A year later, although workers already could stay on the roofs for 40 minutes instead of just 40 seconds, further work was deemed unreasonable. And eventually the roofs were covered with a separate protective structure. The famous chimney continued to dominate the skyline, becoming one of the darkest and most recognizable parts of the Chernobyl landscape. I remember seeing it with my own eyes for the first time in 2009. And just seeing it invoked a strange and very powerful feeling about how much this installation actually had witnessed. That was like this until 2011. At that time, construction of the new safe confinement was underway, and the ventilation stack stood in the way, because the eastern wall of the NSC had to pass right over its location. And so it had to be dismantled, but at the same time, the need for ventilation of the power plant's premises didn't disappear. First, a new, smaller ventilation stack, or so-called NVT, was built next to it. Meanwhile, engineers planned how to move the old 350-ton chimney. Finally, in the autumn of 2013, it was gradually cut into 7 parts, which were then moved one by one using a large demag crane brought from Italy. Not everything went as it was planned, but eventually within 25 days it was removed and placed for storage inside the turbine hall. And ironically, back then I made almost the same what 30 years before did this citizen Segeda VN. With that exception that I climbed unfinished Unit 5, and I had a full permission to do it, because I needed to take these now historical images. How a gigantic crane started to install a new ventilation stack. And although it was little sad to watch, there is one thing I still agree on with that man. The sunset from the reactor's roof was truly incredible. This was just one of many unknown stories of Chernobyl. Check other episodes of our series and find a lot of insights into Chernobyl as a phenomenon on our Patreon page. And we will see you in the next one.